shines the sun. What other majesty rules with justice? Only a holy God. Come and behold him, the one and the only. Cry out, sing holy, forever a holy God. Come and worship the holy God. What a
Good morning and welcome. What a great day it is to worship. We're just so excited to see everybody here today. We pray today that we do a good job of giving God the glory and the honor that He so richly deserves. And for those of you who are watching us on Facebook Live this morning, thank you so much for inviting us into your home. And if you would, take this opportunity to say hello or Merry Christmas to us. And if you don't mind liking us, and if you could take this opportunity to share this morning so that we'll have the opportunity to influence more friends. We really do appreciate that. Again, we enjoy our time together. And let's begin this morning with a prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the blessings of this day and for the opportunity to come and to reflect upon your word. Is just so nice today, Father. We're grateful for this particular season of the year. We pray that we'll take the opportunity to talk to those who might have a limited focus on Jesus Christ, and we might take this opportunity to share the good news with them. We ask this morning, dear Heavenly Father, that you be with the Kirby family in the passing of Brent. Bless Sue Lynn and bless the children and bless this family. Comfort them as you know how. And bless us, Father. And help us to be an encouragement to them and to everyone today. We ask this in the name of Christ. Amen.
How deep the Father's love for us. How vast beyond all measure, that He should give His only Son to make a wretch His treasure. How great the pain of searing loss. The Father turns His face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon the cross, my sin upon His shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held Him there, until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything. No gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, His death and resurrection. Why should I gain from His reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart. His wounds have paid my ransom.
At this time, we'll have a prayer for our Lord's Supper. Heavenly Father, we are gathered here to remember your Son, Jesus. Thankful for the life that he lived and the death that he bore so that we might have freedom from sin. At this time, I ask that you give us forgiveness of our sins so that we might find ourselves worthy this morning to partake from your table. Father, bless us as we are about to partake from the bread, the broken body of our Savior. And it's in his name that we pray. Amen. Bow with me, please. Heavenly Father, as we take from the cup this morning, we do so in remembrance of the blood that was shed on a cross, blood that was essential for the remission of our sins, for a debt that we couldn't pay. And it's in his name that we pray. Amen. Above me are all the ways that you can choose to give this week. And at this time, we'll say a prayer for our offering. Heavenly Father, we find ourselves this morning in a season of gift giving. Father, you gave us the greatest gift of all in your Son, Jesus Christ. Father, this morning I ask that you help us to share that gift. I pray that as we take up an offering this week, that we do so with that in mind. Father, that Jesus came to earth to give and not to receive, and that with the funds that we take up today, that we can continue to serve and do your work here. Father, everything that we do here is for your glory, and it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
The reading this morning comes from Psalm chapter 8. Psalm chapter 8. Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory in the heavens. Through the praise of children and infants, you have established a stronghold against your enemies, to silence the foe and the avenger. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon, the stars, which you have set in place, what is mankind that you are mindful of them, human beings that you care for them? You have made them a little lower than the angels and crowned them with glory and honor. You made them rulers over the works of your hands. You put everything under their feet, all flocks and herds and the animals of the wild, the birds in the sky and the fish in the sea, all that swim the paths of the seas. Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth.
Thank you.
stars are brightly shining. It is the night of our dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and error pining, till he appeared and the soul felt its worth. A thrill of hope the weary world rejoices, for yonder breaks a new and glorious morn.
His power and
Beautiful star of Bethlehem, shining afar through shadows dim, giving a light for those who long have gone, and guiding the wise men on their way unto the place where Jesus lay. Beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine on.
Oh, beautiful star,
beautiful, beautiful star
of Bethlehem.
Star of Bethlehem. Shine upon us until the glory dawn. Oh, give us thy light to light the way into the land of perfect day. Beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine on.
Shine on.
Oh, beautiful star, the hope of light, guiding the pilgrim through the night. Over the mountain till the break of dawn,
the dawn.
And into the light of perfect day, it will give out a lovely ray. Beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine on,
shine on. Oh, beautiful star,
beautiful, beautiful star
of Bethlehem.
Star of Bethlehem, shine upon us until the glory dawn. Oh, give us thy light to light the way into the land of perfect day. Beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine on,
shine on.
Oh, beautiful star, the hope of rest for the redeemed, the good and blessed. Yonder in glory when the crown is won. For Jesus is now that star divine, brighter and brighter he will shine. Beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine on,
shine on. Oh, beautiful star,
beautiful, beautiful star
of Bethlehem.
Star of Bethlehem, shine upon us until the glory dawn. Oh, give us thy light to light the way into the land of perfect day. Beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine on,
shine on.
Good morning. Good to see everybody here today. It's definitely December, isn't it? The cold rain and cold weather. We've had a lot of that going on this week. But it's good to have everybody here today. And Janet and I would like to take this opportunity to say Merry Christmas. From our family to yours, Merry Christmas. We hope it's a good one for you. You know, it's been unusual times. But you know, it seemed like traditional things continue to go on. Isn't that wonderful? I know at our house, Janet's been baking cookies. I guess you can tell. But we have sprinkles and chocolate and flour and everything, you know, scattered here and there. And it's just been great. Of course, I'm a great tester for cookies. I only eat them when I'm by myself or with somebody. I don't have to wait for a major holiday to enjoy cookies. I love cookies. And this year she's tried some new recipes and they've been great. I know it seems that on the news they say that we're cutting, using more live trees this year than ever before. And there's actually been a shortage of Christmas trees. And I've seen some of the trees that you all have put up and decorated and posted, and they're just beautiful. And we take a lot of time, you know, to make things just perfect. And so we decorate and we get gifts and we wrap them. And you know, I'm fairly good at wrapping. I haven't mastered the bows yet. I have too big fingers, I guess. My bows don't turn out pretty like Miss Janet, but she wants them pretty and she wants them perfect, just perfect. And I know we all like to invite family and friends over. Prepare a menu. Everybody over in the comfort of your home. And you want everything to just be perfect. Just perfect. The birth of Jesus Christ was not perfect from man's viewpoint. From a human perspective, it looked like things were out of control. In reality, though, everything was unfolding just as God had planned. He came to an imperfect world for imperfect people, but he came exactly on the schedule. He came at the fullness of time. So today, if you have your Bible, I would like for you to turn to Luke chapter 2. And we're going to see how God brought perfection out of imperfection. And I believe if we looked at Luke chapter 2 today for the first time, we would read that and think, well, there's nothing really there quite ordinary. It looks pretty basic to us. Things are going along as normal. But let's begin reading there together. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth unto Galilee, to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and the line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. You know, the government is always issuing a decree. We read about this all the time. They're always looking for some convenient way to raise taxes. And we don't enjoy paying taxes. We do not like that. This country takes a census every 10 years. But the motivation of the census that we read about in Luke chapter 2 was to gather taxes. Every government is looking for some painless way to gain revenue. So there's nothing out of the ordinary here. We're used to that. We can understand what they're doing. Except everybody here had to go back to the town that they registered. Now, this census, you know, it inconvenienced the entire population of the Roman Empire. Every one of them. They had to get up and go back to their hometown. And it just seems like, you know, that we always have new forms to fill out. And everybody will tell you, when you get a new form, it's just easier to fill out than the old one. Well, I don't always find that necessarily true, do you? No, I don't. Sometimes it's harder. And about the time you get it halfway filled out, you'll lose your internet connection and things like that. It's just very aggravating as what's going on. But everybody had to leave. Everybody had to go back to their hometown. They were crisscrossing all over the Roman Empire, trying to make their way back to their hometown. And you know, that had to be expensive. Not only were you going there so that you could pay taxes, but it had to be terribly expensive for you to travel. It was good for travel agents. It was good for restaurant. It was good for toll booth operators. It was good for innkeepers. But it wasn't necessarily good for the populace. And so Joseph went up from the town of Nazareth to Galilee, to Judea, to Bethlehem, to the town of David, because he belonged to the line of David. Now again, nothing out of the ordinary about this. Nothing that wasn't ordinary. You know, we read about the towns, the places, the people. He came from Nazareth, just a small town, just a little hip community. People would sneer about Nazareth from time to time. Has there anything good come out of Nazareth? But he went to Bethlehem, a really insignificant village. It was a little suburb of Jerusalem, about 5 miles from Jerusalem. And isn't it amazing how he came? He went there with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him, and Mary was expecting a child. Now the plot gets a little bit more interesting, but again, it's nothing really unusual. A couple engaged to be married. Several of you have experienced a December wedding. Nothing unusual about what's going on here. This couple was engaged to be married. The girl is pregnant. And that was a definite stigma in that day, but let's really be realistic. It happens. It does. In fact, almost half the babies born in the United States today are out of wedlock. So it happens. People get carried away with their passion. The first thing you know, there's a pregnancy. And I really doubt if many people believe Mary's story about an angel and a virgin birth. But while they were in Bethlehem, the time came for the child to be born. She gave birth to her firstborn, a son. And it seems like that birth always comes at the most inopportune time. Here they were traveling, didn't need to travel during her pregnancy, but that's what they were doing. She had the child, laid him in cloths, and laid him in a manger because there was no room in the inn. Now think about how sad that was. You can't help but to feel sorry for Mary a little bit. She gives birth to a firstborn son away from home, away from her mother. Delivers him in a sheep pen. But again, that's not too out of the ordinary. We see on the news today where people have had children in taxi cabs and elevators and alleys and that sort of thing. Not really out of the ordinary. I remember when Billy was in high school, our youth minister and his wife were expecting their first. And she wasn't really due till a couple of weeks later, but they had to go on a trip, and they went up into Indiana to ski, and while they were there, it snowed. Not only did it snow up there, it snowed here, and they couldn't get home, and so they had to stay an extra night. And so we were all worried about Steve's wife. So I called her, and I said, "Do not worry. I have a four-wheel drive pickup truck. I'll turn it around right now and face it going out of my drive so we won't have to worry about ice and snow. And if you need anything, you call me. And Billy and I will go over there and get you and make sure you get to the hospital." Billy stayed up all night. It worried him to death that she might call and we have to go get her to take her to the hospital to have that child. And, you know, she did have some false labor pains, probably because of anxiety of her husband being away on a trip with a group of teenagers, and it was time for her to have their child. But I went on to bed. I went to sleep. I'd had children. I had experienced this, and I knew if she did anything, she'd call. We'd take care of her. But Billy stayed up all night worrying about Steve's wife. But that process had to have been very frustrating for Mary. You know, 9 months before, she'd been ecstatic. An angel came and appeared and said, "You're going to conceive the Holy Spirit. You're going to give birth to a special baby. The child that you're going to be carrying is going to be called the Son of God." And she raced to Elizabeth to tell her that story. "I'm going to give birth to a king." And when the time came for the baby to be born, there was nothing spectacular about this. But it seemed like things were out of control. An undesirable trip. Unexpected birth pain. Unavailable room. And where is God in all of this? The Bible doesn't say an angel came by and said, "Don't worry about a thing. Everything's going to be all right." It doesn't say that. There was no voice from heaven. And God had thousands of years to prepare for this moment. Was this the best he could do? Had she been dreaming about an angel coming? The book of Isaiah says, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways." And that's certainly not the way we would have done it. We were not chosen to perform the spectacular in such an unnoticed way. It may have seemed that everything was chaotic, but God was in control. And everything was perfect. Just perfect. Caesar had issued the decree just the right time so that he could move Mary and Joseph miles from Nazareth all the way up to Bethlehem to fulfill the prophecy where the baby was going to be born. And she was going to deliver at the fullness of time. And all the inns were occupied just as God had planned. And the stable was ready and designed just as God had planned. And Jesus would be born in obscurity so that no one could say, well, he had more than they had. And he would rise from poverty. Humble beginnings as a testimony of the power of God. And I believe maybe that God looked down at that scene and said, perfect. Just perfect. But in the midst of the common setting comes an extraordinary thing. The birth of God. And that baby cradled in her arms was no ordinary child. But yet everything would have appeared normal if you'd have seen him. What would he weigh? How long was he? Did he cry? Did he yawn like babies do? Did he make those wonderful sounds that we love to hear? Did he sleep a lot? Was there a soft spot in his head? Yet he was God. He was God. He came to the earth to visit and to save mankind. And John says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And isn't it amazing how he came? He came into this world, but the world received him not. I read this book this week called God Come Near. God Came Near by Max Lucado, and I like what he said on page 23. Majesty in the midst of the mundane, holiness in the filth of sheep manure and sweat, divinity entering the world on the floor of a stable, through the womb of a teenager, in the presence of a carpenter. She touches the faith. She touches the face of the infant God. How long was your journey? This baby had overlooked the universe. These rags keeping him warm were the robes of eternity. His golden throne room had been abandoned in favor of a dirty sheep pen. And worshiping angels had been replaced with kind and bewildered shepherds. Interesting. It just seems that everything was chaotic, but it wasn't. So God chose to announce his birth in two extraordinary ways. The first way he announced the birth of Jesus Christ was by angels to shepherds. Read with me in Luke 2. Let's look at verse 8. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. And they were terrified. But the angel said to them, do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Now God caused the angels to appear to scrubby shepherds. Isn't that amazing? They were not the most influential people of their time. And you know, if I were going to do it, I probably wouldn't have chose shepherds. I might have called the local rabbi, because I felt like he was important. I may have called the mayor of Bethlehem and asked him to come. I probably would have called the press, or at least an innkeeper, to see if he could put somebody else out and put us in. But he didn't do that. Isn't it amazing how he came? The angels appeared to the shepherds outside of town and demonstrated to them that God's gift was available to all men. Look at verse 10. Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all people. And so they hurried. And I don't know if this was the first Christmas rush or not, but they hurried along to see the Christ child. God's second extraordinary announcement came by a star to the wise men of the East. Turn with me to the book of Matthew. And let's look at Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 and 2. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star in the east and have come to worship him." Now, this was quite a contrast to shepherds. Shepherds weren't too influential. And so here we come. These wise men, they were rich. They were Gentiles. Now, we probably wouldn't have selected that. We would have liked to have chosen Caesar, maybe. Possibly invite Herod to come. Maybe Pontius Pilate. I don't know. But God chose men from afar and had them come and worship the Christ child. And you know, right after that, they disappear from the scriptures. I just think that's amazing. And so God was underscoring for everybody that the Christ child welcomed everybody, the near or the far, the rich or the poor, the educated or the uneducated, the Jew and the Gentile. Everyone liked. Everybody was welcome in his kingdom. Even when Christ was a baby, everybody was welcome in his kingdom. And I cannot help but to believe that God was looking down at all this and thinking, perfect. Just perfect. So there are some applications from today's lesson that I would like for us to notice. One, God does dramatic things in undramatic ways. God brings the extraordinary out of the ordinary. God's ways are very different from ours. We're impressed with the grandiose, the spectacular. We're impressed with the beautiful people. And we assume when something really important happens, it needs to happen with a celebrity. It'll be covered by the media. There's a lot of fanfare. But God didn't do that. As a matter of fact, just the opposite is true. He chooses the ordinary things and the weak people of the world to demonstrate his power. Craig did such a good job a while ago reading from the book of Psalm. But let's turn there together and let's look at Psalm 8 together. This is one of my favorite passages of Scripture. He says, "O Lord, our Lord." He's saying, "O Yahweh, O Adonai." It's just amazing. He's given the proper name of God, and now he's using the name, the ruler of the universe. "O Yahweh, O Adonai, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. From the lips of children and infants you have ordained praise, because your enemies to silence the foe of the avenger. And when I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars, what you've set in place, what is man that you are mindful of him? The son of man that you care for him. You've made him a little lower than the heavenly beings and crowned him with glory and honor. You have made him ruler over the works of your hands and put everything under his feet, all flocks and herds and beasts of the field, the birds of the air and the fish of the sea, all that swim the paths of the seas. O Yahweh, O Adonai, how majestic is your name in all the earth." The greatest display of power that we read in that chapter is written for us in verse 2. He uses what we think is seemingly weak from the lips of children and infants. "Have you ordained praise?" I like what the King James Version says there. "Out of the mouth of babes and sucklings, thou hast ordained strength because of thine enemies." Babies. Babies are wonderful, aren't they? I mean, they are wonderful. And can you believe that God says they are a bulwark to silence the enemies? A baby wrapped tightly in a blanket has strength enough to silence the enemies of God. That is just truly amazing. And God established a stronghold through babies to do this. And of course, he does this to remind us of the prophecy that we read 4 weeks ago, the book of Genesis. That's why he did this. And David knew this. He remembered going down the brook and getting 5 smooth stones and using one to kill Goliath, and he was a child. He knew that strength. I also like to read Psalm 8 because our Lord did. If you open your Bible to Matthew chapter 21, you will see where Jesus quoted from Psalm 8. A familiar and favorite passage for him. And so David, he answers his own question here in verse 4. What is man that you are mindful of him? The son of man that you care for him? He crowns this man with glory and honor. And he throws some royal character there because he was a baby. He set him apart from the remainder of creation. Babies, wonderful, wonderful babies. It's just so amazing. And so things seem to be so ordinary for us. Nazareth, Bethlehem, a carpenter, a teenage girl, a stable, a manger, not very impressive. But that was all the setting that was needed for an important event that we read about in Scripture. And God uses this to manifest himself. And I am so thankful that Luke, in trying to convince Theophilus of an excellent way, starts at the beginning and shares the birth of Christ. And if I were going to try to convert somebody today to Christianity, I'd start at the birth of Christ. I'd start where Luke did. I would go there and try to impress you, because we also need to see that he uses common people to be his agents. That includes me and you. And then next, notice that he uses normal circumstances to accomplish his will. You know, Elijah the prophet was so deeply depressed that he hid in a cave. And God calls him and says, step out. I want to show you something. He did. And all of a sudden, a fierce wind comes. Was God in that wind? And then there was a severe earthquake. Was God in that earthquake? And then there was a terrible fire. Was God in that fire? No, he wasn't. But he was in a gentle whisper. A still, small voice, the scripture says. A gentle whisper. God was there. So God appears in the ordinary. God took a rod and parted the sea. God took a rock and quenched the thirst of over 1 million Jews. God took a pebble and killed a giant. He took loaves and fishes and fed thousands. He took grape juice and a wafer that we used this morning to remind us of the memorial that happened over 2,000 years ago. So when he selected disciples, he chose ordinary people. That's probably not what I would have done. I would have probably picked promoters or lawyers or millionaires or orators or administrators, educators. But that's not what he did. He chose ordinary fishermen and a tax collector. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 27, it says, so that no man can boast before him. So when we look at Mary, and when we look at Joseph, and we look at that stable, what we should say is, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Now, what should that say to you and me? Well, in closing this morning, it says 3 things. One, we ought to be perceptive. We can't expect the world to discern the significant the significance of the birth all the way to the cross. We have to teach them. We have to tell them. We have to show them. We have to explain this to people so that they understand. And as we mature in Christ, we've got to develop this increasing capacity to see life from God's vantage point. We need to look through his eyes and see why he did what he did. The Bible calls that wisdom, the ability not to look at things that are seen, but at things that are unseen. You know, Samuel went to the house of Jesse to pick a king, and they showed him the oldest son, said, "Man, he's a good one. Choose him." Samuel said, "No, that's not the one. I don't want it." They went all the way down, all the brothers, and finally they were impressed with a little red-headed boy. The Lord said to Samuel, "Do not consider his appearance or his height, for I have rejected him. The Lord does not look at the things man looks at. Man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart." So he went all the way down to David. Others might see just a shepherd. But if you have perception, you might see a king. Others might see a baby in a poor home. But if we look closely, we might see a savior. And oftentimes it's difficult for people to see. It also means that we should be alert. You know, God does not send us a notice at the beginning of the day and says, "Hey, today's going to be an extraordinary day. You get ready." He doesn't do that. Extraordinary days usually come unannounced. We must be alert to the potential of that every day. You know, on December 7th, Pearl Harbor started out just an ordinary day. Just an ordinary day. And look what happened. In the times of Noah, farms were being bought and sold and planted. Barns were being built. People were given in marriage. Just an ordinary day. And the flood came. September 11th. Where were you on September 11th? Just started out being an ordinary day. You know, we can get out of bed expecting just a routine day and get a call from your mother saying, "I've got bad news. Your dad's had a stroke. Your mother's had a heart attack." We might mention the C word. Your boss might call and say, "Hey, when you get to work today, I need to talk to you." Police could show up at your house. Started out as an ordinary day. And you know, it's not just bad news that comes unexpected. You could have been waiting for a child. Your child could be on the honor roll now. Or a vendor might call and say, "Well, I'd like to double that order I just gave you yesterday. I think I'm going to need more." You know, ordinary, you know, it's good. It's not all bad things that happen. Good things can happen too. Reader's Digest may call and say, "I've got your number. You're now going to receive all kinds of money." Well, you see, that's why we need to walk in God's will every day and be ready for the extraordinary. Listen to what James says. In James chapter 4, "Listen, you who say today or tomorrow, we'll go to this or that city, spend a year there, carry on business, and make money." So, we need to be perceptive, we need to be alert, and we need to be trusting. Mary had been told that her child would be her Messiah. And when all seemed chaotic, she somehow had to trust God that all this would work out. And since God seldom moves dramatically or quickly, it's easy for us to become discouraged. We cannot fathom how he's going to use government decrees or family breakdown or loss of job or ill health or anything to accomplish his will, but he does. And the more we see the way God works in the past, the more we ought to trust him for the present. And he will work the same way in our future. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 and 6. "Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways submit to him, and he will make your path straight." Mary's faith required patience and perseverance. And you know what? So does ours. And the time came for the baby to be born. God works in his time, not ours. So we don't need to hurry God. But we also need to remember that whatever God starts, he always completes. So we need to trust in his wisdom and trust in his will. It takes time to birth a baby. Some of you know better than others. But it also takes time to birth grace and holiness and obedience. And yet we seem to be more concerned with calendar days or weeks or months or minutes. And yet God is concerned with character and integrity and thoughts and values. So it seems that when we want hurry, he wants to hover. And when we want to push, he's just preparing. But in the fullness of time, God sent forth his Son. Holy Father, we thank you for the writings of Luke and Matthew. We're thankful, Father, for your grand design of things, for this miraculous birth. We so desperately needed a Savior to come, to be born, to save us from our sins. We're thankful for your Son, Jesus. And Father, we're so grateful for the sacrifice that he made for us. I just can't imagine. But we are grateful. And it's because of this great sacrifice that one day when it's your time to call, that we pray, Father, when our name is called, you have found us faithful to where that we can serve thee forevermore. Bless us today, Father. In the name of Jesus, amen. We can help you today. Please come while we stand and sing.
My chains are gone. I've been set free. Unending love, amazing grace. Sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood his mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. Through many dangers, toils and snares, I have already come. 'Tis grace hath brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no less day. place to sing God's praise than when we first begun. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. Unending love, amazing.
Good to see everyone again today, and good crowd today, and I know we had a good crowd on Facebook as well. We'll rebroadcast this also on YouTube this afternoon. Just wanted to remind everyone, all the teenagers especially, all the kids, Kids for Christ, and teenagers, they'll be getting their gifts. Eli's done their Secret Santas, and tonight at 6:30, I said Google Meet, but I think it's going to be a Zoom meeting, right, Eli? And he's going to send that code out to our Kids for Christ parents this afternoon so they can get on and have a little fun tonight at 6:30. That's all for K through 5th grade. Just want to remind everyone that for the next 2 weeks, we're not having Bible classes on Wednesday nights, December 23rd and December 30th. If you'd like to go back and watch any videos, they're all on YouTube, and you can watch those, any of the classes. And also, in your Pathfinder today, and then if you're joining us online, there is a devotional inserted in the Pathfinder this morning, and you can find that online on our website to use as a family devotional. Please also remember the office will be closed this Thursday and Friday due to the holidays. And one final note, just wanted to thank everyone, Eli, myself, and Brooks and Caden. We were able to deliver all the Angel Tree gifts. We had over 180 Angel Tree gifts donated from you. We helped about 20 kids. Eli went and helped out, passed out presents to the kids in the community, helped out the social workers, the youth resource team from the local schools, and they helped how many families, Eli?
I believe it was 175 kids.
Over 60 families and over 175 kids, and you were part of that, and those were some of the pictures, and from Miss Angela and the helpers that she had sorting them last week, she wanted to say thank you as well. So thank you for another community-wide effort that we helped out with here from this church. Again, hope you have a great week. Have a good holidays. Keep safe. And Merry Christmas to everyone. And let's end this service in prayer. Dear Father, we thank you for everything that you've blessed us with. We especially thank you for the birth of your Son and his life and his death upon the cross. We wouldn't be here for that. We wouldn't be here and serving you like we need to be if it wasn't for that, dear Father. And we thank you so much for just that opportunity to have a chance to give of ourselves as you and your Son gave to us. Dear Father, let us remember this time of the year each and every day. Not just this time of year, but let's continue to spread this love all the moments and days of our lives so we can share with others that are around us the glorious message that has been brought to us. Thank you again. We ask and pray that you be all with all those that have lost loved ones, especially the Kirby family. Be with Miss Sue Lynn and all the family during this time. Be with them tonight as they have visitation and tomorrow at the funeral as well, dear Father. Just let us continue to reach out to them and be a blessing to them as we best can. Be with those that have been on the prayer list or have been suffering through illnesses, and just continue to let us be there for them as well. Be with us this week. Keep us safe. Let us enjoy time, if we can, with family and friends. And let us use this time of the holidays to just grow closer together as family, as brothers and sisters, and through you. Thank you again for everything. It's your son's name we pray. Amen.